Yeah,
look what I did. What? Sit down. Stay there. Come here. Come here. Good ball.
Pleased to say, joined by Pat Barrett, or should I call you the dog whisperer, Pat?
No, Pat Barrett.
Timid dog, but you've got a knack with the animals.
I think animals are just like people, they've got to learn to trust them. And that's what it was. I gained an early trust with that dog. I showed him that he had no need to be worried and threatened with me.
So we're over here, brought Lyndon over for some sparring with Jordan. Good sparring as well. He's both sort of similar kind of level of coming through the ranks. So good for both of them, really.
I think with Jordan, I think what it is with Jordan, what I like about Jordan, I think he's a very good prospect coming out of Manchester. I think he's one definitely tipped to do a lot. His style is very ranger, he's very awkward. He's a bit like a Deontay Wilder, really. I mean, when he starts learning to get behind that jab even more, he's going to be a very dangerous kind of guy to fight. And the fact, what I like, what he does with Lyndon, he makes Lyndon think because he uses that jab. And with Lyndon getting in with somebody who's got a good left jab just like himself, I mean, it allows him to learn to move that head, where before he doesn't move his head as much because he doesn't think he has to. And that's why I like bringing him down there, getting his sparring with Jordan. Well, the way I see it with this box, I always look to the top of me. I don't look at the level of where I'm at. I like to look past the level of where I'm at. And I think Lyndon is going to meet a lot of these good kids. I mean, like Jose Burton, for instance. I mean, he's another good, tall, rangy guy. He's fight everywhere with a jab. And, you've got to look at one day you might be fighting these kind of guys who are very talented and very good. He's got a good jab, got a good backhand. So these are the kind of things that you've got to look at, even though we're not there yet. We have to look at getting there. And we might as well look at it from now. So this is why we come around, travel around, going on sparring.
5th of May, is it? The 12th of May?
No, 5th of May.
5th of May, yeah. Bowlers, so it's just next fight out. He's been keeping busy, but he's, considering from last year, it's a slow start to the year, but hopefully...
Better going down. I mean, I think, getting Lyndon on these bigger shows now, it's far more important than him just fighting on these normal shows. I think he could do with the exposure now. He's good enough to get out there. I mean, it's the same as his cousin, Zelfa. And it'd be good to have them both featuring on the same show. And I think that's on the 9th of June. Not confirmed 100% with that's Zelfa's return with Ronnie Clarke.
Not really spoke to you on camera, Pat. Yourself, I spoke to Zelfa, about the... Ronnie Clarke defeat. You have plenty of time to look back on it. What's your assessment now with a few weeks past it?
I mean, my views on it, look, there's no excuse at the end of the day. If one fighter is mentally stable or stronger than another fighter, then that fighter who's got the stronger mind is going to win. That's what I know of boxing. It's just like when Sugar Ray Leonard fought Roberto Duran the first time. What happened? We all know what happened. Ray Leonard got beat. He got beat. He fought the wrong fight. Maybe it was other problems to his mind. We don't know. But he got beat. Now, same with Zelfa and Ronnie Clarke. Zelfa was undefeated. He's beating everybody. He's a good, talented prospect. Sometimes when you say to get lost in their own success, I don't think success Zelfa's never had, because as far as I'm concerned, he was noticed. But let's say success is something you'd achieve. He's only been English champion, and that's not really success to me, is it? You know what I mean? So when he says success, let's be honest, it's sometimes success to me on these young kids is social media success. That's where they're successful, yeah? And that's what I'm trying to get. Hey, listen, let's not get it twisted. To be successful and to be highly recognized as a good fighter is a difference between social media and boxing journalism noticing you and people from outside. So this is where we capture it now. So with Zelfa now, he realizes between the two and the difference. And now Zelfa's, he's back at home and he's working hard in the gym. And yeah, will you see a different Zelfa? course you're going to see a different Zelfa. Because if you wasn't going to be a Zelfa, see a different Zelfa, I wouldn't be in the corner with him. And that's the truth. What I have got from Zelfa is a total, complete Zelfa that I like. Yeah. And then I look so much forward for the return. And I'd like to thank Ronnie Clarke and his stable for giving us a return, as we would have given them. Mm-hmm. You don't expect to win a fight, you win a fight. You don't expect to have a good camp, you have a good camp. If you don't have a good camp, you don't have a fight. So let's keep it on a very tight level here, right? Zelfa got beat, right, off a kid that was better than him on the night. End up. Yeah, we can make excuses, oh, we fought the wrong fight, oh, it was this, oh, it was that. No, it wasn't. Okay? This time round, right, we'll go off this time round. Plain and simple. We've got the return, right? All I do is look forward for the return. And that is plain and simple. So what I don't want to be doing is making Zelfa believe that there is an excuse to the fight. We just accept that we got beat on the night, that's it, plain and simple, right? We're so fortunate to get the return to prove that we're better than what we did do. All I can say, Sugar Ray Leonard, Roberto Duran, we fought the wrong fight, yeah? Right? Well, not I fought the wrong fight, Zelfa fought the wrong fight, okay? This time round, he'll fight the correct fight and he'll put it right.
So, it could do in the world of good. All in all, you know, that kind of thing in a boxer's career, it can be a making of a boxer.
One loss can be better than 10 wins, right? Okay? That one loss can turn you into a 10 times better fighter than him. I'm not going to compare, and I will not compare, because me and Zelfa are two different guys, and we're two different fighters. We're just family, and I don't want to be under me. But the first time I ever lost to a fighter called Paul Burke, yeah, and that was my third defeat. I decided I would never get beat again. And I had a good run for 5 years before I moved up to fight Manny Galloway for the world title. And that was my next defeat. But for 5 years, I was undefeated, like welterweight champion. Okay, at 10 stone, I was unbeaten in 35 fights. Right? So let's just say, it's not impossible, is it? Right? And with the mentality and with the training that Zelfa's got and the camp that he's got, just like, let's just say, nothing's impossible.
It'll be good to see him back in there and pushing on. Yeah, loads of talent. There's a show coming up as well, Pat, a Black Flash show in June.
Yeah, yeah.
Maylett Arena, you've got a lot of lads in the gym coming through. Good prospects, Tommy Fury, Dean Lang, Ben Mulligan, who's back in and training, looking good as well.
Yep.
Been a few changes, a few boxers have come and gone, which happens in camps as well.
Yep.
But let's talk about the next fight, next show, and who's going to be on it.
Well, we've got Thomas Fury, we've got Dean Lang. Dean Lang is a very good, you know, three-time ABA finalist. Who's also won. What did he win now? He won the Golden Cup, the championship from Newcastle. He's a belting prospect. He's even fought our very own Lyndon Harper as well in the championships. Lyndon beat him. It was a very close decision. You've also got another boxer who's just turned pro with us called John Arden, Czechoslovakian kid, southpaw, middleweight, very good, very talented. He's had over 60 fights, amateur fights in his country, he's champion over there. He's absolutely brilliant, which is unheard of really, to put a Czechoslovakian fighter on your own show. He doesn't really sell tickets, but I believe that he's that good that, you know, we've got sponsorship that will cover him. We've also, on the bill, we've got John Arden, Dean Lang, Ben Mulligan and Thomas Fury, and Denton Fussell topping the bill, fighting for the Central Area title. So, you know, for a small old show, it's very compact with talent, a lot of good prospects, and four of them prospects are my own, and then we have our very own experienced fighter, Denton Purcell, who was former Commonwealth champion.
So we'll look forward to that one.
Yeah.
Tommy Fury's come, I know you spoke recently on the video, but he's come over to train with you. You know the Fury's well, you used to train Tyson for a while.
Yeah.
We'll speak about that in a minute, but Tommy, he's a really good prospect, 18 years old. He's very mature mentally and physically for an 18-year-old. How have you found working with him?
Working with Tommy's, you know, he's, he reminds me a lot of his brother in certain ways, where sometimes he would drift off. But after we've sat down and we've had a talk with him and his dad, he's come back in the gym and he's a total. What I like about Tommy is he's really good. He's like any other fighter. You talk to him and he comes back different. You sit down, you get views from it, he comes back better. Yeah, and he's always going to be like that. He's a young fighter, he's up and coming, he's a prospect and a half, he's talented. He had, I think it was 11 amateur fights, he won 10, and the one that he did lose, that's why he decided to turn pro, because he realised his style that he's got is not going to work in the amateurs. He's always going to go along, getting robbed, getting losses and whatever. But as a pro, he's fitted, he's like a duck on water, he's absolutely fitted into this pro style, this game. His attitude is amazing. His character is amazing. His personality is amazing. There's nothing I can say that I don't like about this kid. Yeah, it's like I've had him forever. And I've only had him for a few months, a couple of months. But working with him is so easy to work with. And for me to say that about a fighter, and it's more positive than it is negative, then that tells you a lot, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, we look forward to seeing him out. We're going to do something with him soon, in a little profile video, and follow him about and stuff like that. So that'll be good, won't it?
Well, I look forward to seeing that when that documentary comes out about him, because that tells you a lot about a fighter and about our future.
Yeah, we'll get that done. It'll be good, that. Look forward to it. You used to train Tyson, didn't you? His brother, obviously, and, you know, for a while he came to the gym when Brian was still there. He's flitted about a bit, Tyson, and he's not training with Peter now, I believe, too. But he's going to be making a comeback soon, with no specific date in mind or anything like that, but he looks like he's getting back in shape and everything. It'll be good to see him back, but I'm sure as a personal friend of his, you'll like to see him back in there as well.
I think a lot of people have written Tyson off because, you know, the way he is, but what you've got to realise, Tyson is a fighter that, you know, is a very strong-minded kind of guy, and what he says he actually believes, and if he says that he can go away, come back and be world champion and put his mind to it, why couldn't he? He was just to say that he couldn't. I mean, don't get me wrong, Anthony Joshua is a brilliant prospect. He's absolutely one of the best we've got in Britain. You know, nobody can take nothing away from Anthony Joshua for what he's achieved and what he's done. But at the same time, let's not write a fighter off because of how his lifestyle's been. They're the worst ones you can ever, you know, think about, because they're dangerous. Yeah, and Tyson can come back being anything as a ghost. You just don't know what you're going to get with Tyson. So, you know, you can't prepare for something what's unknown. He's a ghost. Yeah. And even if you watch him in his comeback fight and you think you've got something to go off, don't go off that. Because, you know, a man can't be out the ring for so long and then have a fight and then look at his greatest. So, I mean, you just need that, because behind all that first fight, that comeback fight, you're going to change immensely. Just get the cobwebs off you. But I guarantee when you get back into the gym, you're going to change.
Yeah. What was it like working with him that time? You was there as Brian was doing it now as well, and you and Brian always said, you know, this guy's got the potential to be a heavyweight champion. He's knew that, and probably everyone who worked with him knows that. It's just, and it, well, he went on to prove he's right.
Yeah.
What was he like working with him? What makes you so sure he's got that?
To me, he was a gentleman. He was like his brother. He was one of the best. What he said he did. I remember Tyson one time, he used to like to play about a lot in the gym, and his character, and it wasn't my mentality of doing that. And I remember sitting down having a talk with him and having a talk with his dad, and he come in the gym and he apologised about that, and he said, you know what, Pat? He said, I promise you, I'll be a champion. And I said, there's no doubt about it. And this is when he was 18 years old, and I said, there's no doubt you will. We took him over to Germany, me and Brian. He absolutely cleaned out that German gym over there in sparring. Did what he said he was going to do. We come back, we worked with him for the one fight that we had, and we said we'd do that, you know, we'd do that to see if he enjoyed working with us. The deal was done that year, he was going to sign, he enjoyed working with us, and it was great. A little incident happened between myself, which became a personal issue that allowed me to take time out of the gym for a little bit. That, you know, couldn't allow Brian to put him on the pads and whatever. And when Tyson did see me say when I was coming back to the gym, it was unfortunate that I couldn't give him a set time when I was going to come back in the gym. And that's when his uncle Peter took over the training of Tyson. But as a fighter, and then as a what you call it, you know, if Tyson doesn't, you know, Tyson's got to have respect for you in order for you to work with him, and you've got to have respect for him in order for you to work together. You've got to be able to gel, and we did gel, we did click, and we did have a lot of good times, and we did have a good laugh, and that's why we happen to be good friends even to this day, because, you know, I've got a lot of respect for Tyson, and the feeling's mutual.
That was a good story when you said you went over to Germany sparring and he was messing about the first couple of days and Brian was almost on his way home. It was a, you know, great story you told me. It just showed you the mentality once he switches
what
on.
What it was, you know, he wasn't switching on, he was going in the gym, he was dancing about, hands down, and he was, you know, and I'm thinking, well, Brian's not too well. He's come all the way over to Germany with you. And remember, me and Tyson was sharing a room together, and Brian had his own. And I remember we sat up, we were like two little kids, and, you know, he's across the room, across the room from me, and I'm across. And I'm having a chat with him, saying, "Listen, Tyson, you can't do that." You know, I said, "Brian's not a poorly man." I said, "Listen, this man's looked out for me all my life, and I can't let you do this to him." And he goes, and we had a good conversation, and I was about to go to sleep, and I heard pat. And I said, "What, Tyson?" He goes, "I promise you one thing. Yeah, watch tomorrow. No messing about. I'm going to go there and I'm going to get the business done. Watch." And he went in there, quiet as hell, right? Warmed up. And, you know, he had this look in his face. And then he got in the ring. And what was the Cuban kid called over there? It was over in Germany. Yeah, the cruiserweight.
Well, you've stumped in there, Pat.
Huh? There was a cruiserweight that they had boxed at that gym, and there was also the big, I think it was a Swedish or whatever guy, blonde hair, and he sparred with him, the heavyweight, and he absolutely pulverized everyone he sparred behind that jab, and he put the punches together. It was absolutely $1 million. Even Brian said, when he come out, Brian said, he's going to be a world champion. I'm telling you now, Pat, this kid is the one. That's what he told me, and you know what? You know, it's just unfortunate that I wasn't there when he did win the world title, really. But, you know, I can be there for when his brother goes on to do bigger and better things. Yeah. Because his dad was, I was very fortunate that his dad phoned me up and said, "I've got the youngest here, Tommy Fury, and I want you to train him," he says. And it was nice for them to choose me as a trainer for the younger brother, which is Tommy. And I think Tommy, I'm going to keep promoting until I get Tommy 8-9-0. Yeah. And I'm going to do the same thing as what I've done with my lads. Zelfa and Lyndon and all my boxers. I'm going to keep him busy out there. I'm going to be putting on all these small shows just to get him out there, keeping him busy and getting him the fights and getting him the experience. Because he's only had like 11 amateur fights, won 10, won the novice championships, and now he's ready to go pro. So, you know, he's won, but he's only a baby in the game. And, you know, there's a lot of looking after, a lot of taking me time. I'm not going to get nobody rush anything with this kid. I'm just going to take my time with him.
Yeah. You used to spar with his dad as well, didn't he?
I sparred once with him. Come on now, he's a heavyweight, yeah. You know, Big John. And it was only for Brian to make a point to me, because I was stopping everybody, and I said to Brian, "Do I have to train this hard?" And I remember the story. Brian said, "Yeah, try and do the favor, just keep a few rounds." And you know, John was the kind of person, he was like playing with a bull. You just don't play with a bull, do you? And no matter who we get in the ring with, he just sees what you call it. And I remember, you know, I must have caught him and wound him up, but he just kept coming. And I remember just moving like a fly, just trying to be quick, just don't let this big guy near me, because he would crush me. And that's all I kept doing, just moving, hitting and running. And after 6 rounds, I was on my back. I couldn't do it no more. Because I thought to myself, I'm not going to knock this guy out. I'm not even going to hurt him. So why am I doing this? It's a pointless thing I'm trying to speak to Brian. But Brian made a point. And he said, "Look, this is what would happen if they still come in after 6 rounds. Yeah. So yeah, you do have to do this hard work." Ever since from there, I realised what hard work was about in the gym. Yeah. I never asked that question again.
Yeah, it made you realise it once you did get in them fights. Yeah. Like, Like saying, you could sugar your brood coming forward.
It's the hard work that pays off, that creates the knockouts and the determination of being a fighter. And that's what I'm talking about, going back to Zelfa. It's the hard work and the determination and that self-discipline that will win things.
Yep, I mean, you know, these days the social media side of boxing and all that, you need it as in a business side trying to get out there, but I know you're not a great lover and all the boxers doing it all the time, are you? And it's getting it out, you know, in your day, it wasn't the kind of thing you would do.
If I was to give my statement on what I think of social media, I think I'd have every boxer in Britain hating me. Do you know what I mean? Because, you know, it wasn't about in my era. And I can imagine a lot of people, there's this thing that I hear that if you get this blue tick, but then if you're clever, you use it for advertisement. So you become a billboard. So you have things where it's just advertising other people's companies that are paying you. Yeah, but as far as promoting yourself on social media, about your lifestyle, what you're doing, what you're eating, I think it's a joke because you're not fighting men to me. That's not a fighting man. A fighting man is, look, you want to know what I'm about? Come and watch me fight. You want to know from what I'm about? Watch me knocking people out. Yeah, I don't need to show you this on social media. I don't need to sell myself on social media. What I will do is I'll thank my sponsors that's helping me get to where I get or want to be in this career of so much. But anything else is a joke. Yeah. And I've told all my boxers, I barred all that in the gym. You don't come in taking pictures. There's no social media thing. It stops. I've ripped it up.
Close the door.
Anybody what comes in with it will get thrown out the gym. Because it's ridiculous. Because that's where they're getting lost. They're becoming social media champions rather than real champions. Really getting recognised and noticed for who you are, for what you do, for what you're going to achieve. So you're talking to the wrong person on social media.
Listen, I'm with you on that one. I'm a bit of a dinosaur myself. On that.
Right, okay.
Yeah, definitely. No, it's interesting what you said there about, I know I enjoy listening to you tell the lads sometimes when you talk about, like you said, there'd be a fly when John was coming off fly, and you'll give little analogies like that to the boxers, you know, to make them think, and you're one for really getting in their heads, and you know how, you know, mentally important it is to get through to a boxer.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. What's going to make this fight very interesting? The return for Zelfa and Ronnie Clarke. Ronnie Clarke, he's a tough guy mentally. He's a tough guy physically, right? He's like, he's being one of these kickboxers, same as what I used to do before I did boxing. Yeah. So when we talk about things like that, we fight mentally. We don't fight physically. We fight mentally. Yeah, we're mental tough people. Yeah, this Ronnie Clarke is a mental tough guy. I know this guy. Yeah, I looked at him when I seen him at the weigh-in, and I looked him in the eye. And this guy's a serious guy. Yeah, and what I'm trying to say to Zelfa, this guy's a serious guy. Take him seriously. Yeah, I can only say to what a fighter can do. That fighter doesn't do what I say. There's 2 points to it, isn't there? Right? This time round, it's going to be mental toughness against mental toughness. Yeah, because before it was against mental toughness against physical toughness. Yeah. That's why he won. Yeah. This time round, it's going to be mental toughness and physical toughness against mental toughness and physical toughness. It's going to be who's going to crack. Ask me what the decision's going to be. Ask me what the outcome's going to be. I won't have a clue until on the night. And until them two men meet in that ring and come together and touch gloves and walk away, that's when we're going to know. Yeah. Later on in the fight, whose mind's going to crack? Who's gonna unfold? Who's gonna ravel? Yeah. Now we're playing to the way it should have been done the first time. We're doing it now, the second time. Now, like I said, I'm never gonna take nothing away from Ronnie Clarke, because he is what he is. You know, people need to take the hat off to that kid. And he's a better fighter than a lot of people would give him credit for. A 10 times better fighter, including myself. Yeah. I'm giving this kid all the maximum respect, and I'm prepared with him now. Like, this is, we don't have no other fight in our life. We've got to get past this. Okay? physically and mentally. Yeah. And if anybody wants to talk to me about this, that's all I've got to say. Mm. What I've said to you, I've got nothing more to say to anybody else apart from this.
Mm. You're still loving being a trainer, or Pat, you've got your ambition, you know, you want to create world champions and you know, listen, carry on Brian's legacy. You're still, you know, you're doing well at the training, you're enjoying it, main thing.
I'm going to use Brian's words, and Brian's words were, I'm a dreamer. Yeah, one day I'm going to dream that I'm going to have a world champion. Or one day I'm going to dream that I'm going to have a gym full of champions. What I produce and train myself, I manufactured in that gym. Same thing with what Brian said. And how would Brian use his first champion? And hopefully I'll have many champions coming out of that gym. And you know, hopefully that can keep that legacy going up of Brian uses. And one day be a great trainer like Brian uses, even though I am a great trainer now. But you know, I'm still at the peak of my career as a trainer. So one day, you know, I've worked with greatest fighters, Robbie Reed, Mike Jennings, Gomez, Farnell. You know, I've worked with all the glorious greats, yeah. And I've been able to have Brian at side of me, you know what I mean, doing that.
What still motivates you and keeps the fires burning to succeed as a trainer, to continue Brian's sort of legacy in for the gym?
I would say commitment. I would say being committed to what Brian was. Brian used to sacrifice everything to make sure that we had everything. It wasn't about himself. He put the boxers first. He put the boxers ahead of his own family, what he used to do, the sacrifices he would make. And that's the same thing that I would do. The only thing that Brian never did was do what I'm doing, was build a promotional thing to give his own kids a career, because I've got kids in the gym that I've never done anything as an amateur, yeah. But I can see that these kids are talented, that they wouldn't get a career in this world today. Now what I do find and believe that I can give kids a career and a dream and something to believe in. So that's the beauty of the promotional side, and it all comes together. And with getting all the help of people that help it coming in, the sponsoring it and things like that, you know, to help it go forward, to me, that's the greatest thing, because, you know, before I never had no sponsors. I mean, I like to thank, you know, we've got RDX, Andrew Cowley Construction. So, I mean, you know, we've got a good few sponsors.
Pat, been great to speak to you. Looking forward to the show coming up. I'll get up to the gym next week and we'll have another catch up and start this thing with Tommy.
Thank you.
Be good.
And first of all, listen, the main thing that we would never do this and we would never be where we were today, we've got to thank who's been with us from day one, British Boxers.
That's good of you to say.
Cheers, Chris.
God bless you, man.